Hey beautiful people, it's your favorite TV brownie, Mwambe. Welcome right back to my channel and you're on the cruise with Mwambe. On my show today, I'm going to be having someone very interesting, very engaging, very interactive, someone that has quite a vast knowledge of teenagers and youth. And trust me, this vlog is one that you do not want to miss. Like, it's going to be very, very interesting. So guys, let's meet my guest. Let's meet Mr. Shegu.
Thank you for having me.
Welcome on the show.
Thank you.
So Mr. Shegu, beyond everything I've said, I would like you to introduce yourself to my viewers at home.
Okay, well, my name is Shegu Anyoroba, and then I've worked with young people for a couple of 25 years now. Yeah, one of the things that I love to help them to do is to see a great vision beyond the present that they are in. And that's what a lot of young people really find. The difficulty with them is transiting from no vision to finding vision to fulfilling the vision. Something that I've worked with young people for that long.
That's quite interesting. So it is safe to say that you see it in the space of the millennial and Gen Z.
Well, if you want to say that.
Okay. So you said you've been working with these people for 25 years.
If
okay.
Yeah, that about or more.
That's quite interesting. So what's that thing that you know made you say, okay, you want to work with teenagers and youth? What's that thing that, you know, brought about interest in this age bracket? Because I feel like a lot of people do not even know what they want to do, and it's quite difficult to work with individuals in that age bracket. So what exactly brought about your interest?
Well, for me, it's about the difficulty in them connecting. The difficulty that I... Well, okay, let me start with using myself as an example. At a very early age, in my life, I was able to find purpose. So as a 13, 14, I had a very strong idea of what my life was going to be like and the journey I was going to be in through life. Then as I journeyed through my early 20s, I realized that if I do not make commitments to help a lot of younger people know what I knew at that young age, I wouldn't be happy growing up seeing lots of young people just wandering about, no vision, no goal, just live as life comes. And that was when I believed that I think I should commit myself to this. So regardless of what I do by the side, putting up activities to encourage young people to know what they should do with their life was part of my basic course of living.
So it's more like you giving back.
Oh yeah, absolutely giving back.
Interesting. I'm going to ask you this. What has been the most difficult thing in training and equipping youth?
Okay, well, for me, it's the biggest challenge that I've dealt with over the years is just the effort to help them see that a great future is possible regardless of the economic situation. That has been one major challenge. And of course, sometimes it gets me a bit impatient because you make so much effort. I mean, I do a lot of one-on-one approach. You make so much effort to help someone see that, forget what you're seeing today, there is something bigger coming tomorrow. And all you need to do is just to put yourself in shape, prepare yourself what's coming. So, I mean, the biggest challenge is them believing enough in a future.
Okay.
And start preparing for it. Now, it's one thing to believe that you can achieve a great future, but the belief is not complete without that adequate preparation, which often is measured by how well you can discipline yourself today for a greater good that you see for your life tomorrow.
Okay. So, from what I'm going to say next now, I'm like, these teenagers, are you saying that a whole lot of them do not even believe in themselves?
Well, that's a major problem in Africa. Quite a number do not believe in themselves. There are lots of young people today who just live life as it comes. I mean, it takes a lot to believe in yourself, especially when the society tells you, oh, you are this, because a lot of young people, check it out, most of them face rejection from their parents, they are being bullied by their friends, they look in the media and they see what life is in the media.
Okay.
But it is not the same as what it is in real time. So there are too many internal conflicts that a young person deals with. So of course you can look at that and say that there is a big challenge in actually knowing who you are, and knowing what you should be doing with your life, not informed by something on the external, but informed by something that comes from within you. And of course, that is only possible when you cut off a lot of the things that feed your mind and start to ask yourself some thought-provoking questions. And guess what? These things only happen best when you are young.
That's quite interesting. I'm going to like this. Okay, you know, kids will turn.
Like
I do. I'm just saying, like, went off more interesting, you know. Kids will turn into teenagers, teenagers will turn into young adults, and then like that. Okay, so now there are a lot of positive agents, from parenting to, you know, teachers at school to pastors and leaders in church to social media space. Now we're going to start from the foundation, the background, which are the parents. What are you going to say is actually like, what are you going to say is the major issue from the home, from the parenting space, that makes a lot of teenagers not believe in themselves, that makes a lot of teenagers go off their route in life, that makes them miss their purpose in life?
Well, for me, I would say that quite a number of teenagers have a life that is being dictated to them by their parents. Not every parent understands the fact that your child is born to be distinct and not necessarily born to be who you are, or as it were, take off from where you will stop. So the goal of every parent should be to discover what their child, I'm married, I have three children, and I study my children carefully, and I know that they are very different in their approach to life. One of my greatest joy is that I'm learning them as they grow, I'm observing them as they grow, and I'm seeing that, oh, this will be the path that you want to go, this will be. But in a case where you don't have parents like that who just want to tell you this is what you will do and nothing can change it, that is one of the biggest killer, because you find that you live a life that is not yours. You live a dream. I've met several young people who tell me, we do quite a number of campus outreach, and I talk to a lot of students every now and then. Why are you studying this course? Well, my mother asked me to study this course. Why are you studying that course? Well, that's what my father really wants. So what do you really want to do? They don't even want to know. But because of, an average African child learns to respect their parents and all that, but in the long run, it hurts them also. Of course, it's still one we said that we all have to learn to balance. How do you please your parents and also please yourself? Or how do you please your parents without displeasing yourself? So, you know, you find that they live a life that is not really theirs, and it's a big challenge. Because if you live a life that is not yours, it's difficult to help you see a future, because it wasn't something that you really, really want to do.
So I think that it's safe to say that parents have a role of things to do in molding their children.
Of course, because the first mold that a child passes through into society is the family. Now we see quite a number of churches today doing so much, helping young people here and there. But I believe that the church is the role of the church in molding the destiny of the youth is remedial. Because if the family has not failed, the church will not need to put in so much effort, so much activities, teenagers program, help you to discover purpose. These are basic things that, should have been done by your parents. I was speaking with a young lady some days ago. I just met her and we just got talking. And I found out she was not even a Christian. She was not raised as a Christian, okay, because we expect a lot more from Christians, but she wasn't even raised a Christian. But what I found out was that the level at which the kind of values that she had as a young lady was very, very amazing. I spoke with her for over an hour. And I can tell you that for this one that I spoke with her, I didn't speak for up to 5 minutes. She had a lot to say. I was just listening. Now, the first thing she said that got me was like, when she was in school, she had friends who were having sex. But she has told her friend that no, she does not think it is right to go into sex until you're married. Okay.
Okay.
And the friends would look at her like, what kind of person are you? You mean this age and time you will do this? Then she mentioned something that they tried, they did everything humanly possible to set her up, to get guys to hear. Now, she said that, in fact, when she said that, my mind just, I just like, wow, what kind of value is this?
Amazing.
She said that they were trying so hard to get her to be on their level. Now, because that is the only way they can feel equal. Do you understand? But the value that she had built over time made her stood out from her peers. Do you get that? You get what I'm saying? The value she had built for herself made her distinct. But her friends look at her like she's too distinct from them. So they are looking for a common, they are looking for a common ground. So they kept on encouraging her all that. And she said quite a number of things that you just meet a guy and then the next thing you are dating. And I was like, what is this? These are values that we even try to teach a lot of Christians and they feel like it's weird. Who does that? And I'm like, this is a young person who was not even raised in a Christian home with so much values. Now I'm saying that to say that the shortfall is from the family. And that's why the family needs to pay a lot of attention to ensuring that their children get these values right.
So parents have to do a lot.
A whole lot.
So now we're saying that the school, the religious institutions are secondary.
Very secondary.
But now if the home has failed in raising these children, what more can the school do and the religious institutions do?
Well, there's nothing more that they can do than they are doing currently. I mean, you see quite a number of churches and here and there, organizing programs, back to school program for teenagers, youth camp, youth retreat, success camp here and there. I mean, I believe to a very large extent, the goal of some of these activities are not just to make you spiritually quote, because what's the goal of being spiritual if you don't have values? If what's the goal of praying and there are no values? Because the real deal is, what value are you bringing to the table? What is changing about your values? Your value is how you see life. I mean, your values are like guiding principles for you. Do you even have things that guide you? Okay, so the goal of these activities for me is help you develop the right values for life. Like, of course, if you check an average Jewish person, which of course forms the basis of the, I mean, Christians, so I'm not talking about the Christian faith. If you check an average Jewish youth, you find that from the word go, their parents instruct them in the Torah, morning and night, every day. So you find that an average Jew as a teenager is already distinct from their peers. As a matter of fact, they are even more studious. They read much more than their peers. Now, you wonder how when they become much older, they stand out very fast because they've taken in values at a younger age. And you know the principle of sowing and reaping is what you put in that comes out. So if you don't put in good values, you're not going to be able to exchange values for money in life.
That's true. Okay, so now let's bring you home to what is currently happening to teenagers in Europe, the social media space. A lot of teenagers see young adults, maybe in their 30s, and they're like, oh, okay, she has a bed. Oh, he has his house. Oh, she's doing this, and she's doing that. Some of them don't even consider the age difference.
And they just want to.
And just want to. You just want it that fast. Oh, if she can have it,
I can have it.
I can also have it. A lot more people are desperate. Some people even wish, which is even okay. A lot of people are even more desperate to achieve quite a lot. A lot of people compare, and then all these things will not come home to having teenagers who are falling into depression,
desperately.
Some of them are even giving up on life. And I'm like, first of all, we cannot cancel social media. We cannot say we don't want social media because the world keeps evolving
over
time.
Evolving.
So I'm like, how can we help these teenagers, these young adults, the youth, to see that, okay, social media is different from reality. You can do a lot more behind the scenes. Social media is only for you to project whatever you choose to put there. Because it affects a lot of things that are happening. People are sitting on drugs, on alcohol, just to feel good, just to feel alone. Some people don't even have the strength, the capability to do all these things. They are not even strong enough, but they just want to, you know, fit in. And there's a whole lot of wrongs out there. So I just feel like, okay, how do we balance the social media space and young individuals achieving purpose and doing great things in life?
Okay, so first and foremost, speaking about the rate at which young people are getting prone to depression, it's quite alarming, okay? Quite a number of young people are falling into depression and in that life. What is the impact of social media in the rate at which they get depressed? They see a life that they want to copy. They want to be like Beyoncé. They want to be like Jay-Z. They want to be like Davido. And they have so many role models that they are looking up to. But they look at the gap and the amount of time it would take for them, in quotes, to blow. So the thoughts of these things are quite overwhelming. Now, I this is what I keep saying. An empty mind will keep producing an empty life. If your mind is empty and all you ever have there is Jay-Z, which are not bad people, but I'm saying that if there are no, for me, social media is just, it's as good as just get entertained and forget about it.
Okay.
It entertains you, leave it there. Don't take anything from social media into your, don't copy, don't do what's this word. Hook line, don't take everything, hook line, sinker. Okay, as a matter of fact, there are so many things that social media teaches people that they consciously also ignore. But that's why you find that people who fake a life that they are not on social media tend to get the best attention also, because that's what a lot of people are looking for. They just be like, oh well, yeah, of course. So you look at the issue of the young man that was a fraud the other day, and then there are quite a number of them, because they just believe that if you do not have so much material things, then you are not, then you don't command respect. But if you check from the scriptures, the word of God rightly says that a man's life is not in the abundance of the things that he possessed. That's why I say that an empty life will produce an empty life. If there are no godly driven values in your heart guiding you against what you see that makes you want to every day want to compare yourself, why am I not like, I mean, trying to be like Jake Dangote's daughter, imagine what if I was born here. But my brother, wake up to reality and just accept yourself. As a matter of fact, do you know that the biggest gifts in life are not the ones that we labor for? The biggest gift, the greatest value, asset, your bread. You didn't have to pay anything for it. Your eyes, you see things free. There are men who would pay millions to just see, okay? The air you breathe, your heart, all these things, they are priceless. They are so priceless. So how come you ignore the greatest asset that you have? And you think that it's by having so much material, and it's not just with the youth, okay? It is common with even adults. There is this unhealthy chase to have. You just want to have this car, well, because you believe, if I don't have this car, my neighbors won't see me in this particular perspective. And even when you can't afford it, you just go all you can, you go borrow, you go loan, and all of that, you know. So I'm saying that the impact is negative because we allow it to, and because an empty mind will produce an empty life. So I say that get knowledge, read what builds you, not just what makes you want to compete and be like others.
Still on the line of thought here, we're going to go on and on and on and on to talk about the curses, the effects, and all of that. But way forward, what can be done to redeem teenagers so they will not become that depressed, you know, angry and unsatisfied at all? Because a lot of people are going down that way. A lot of people are going, oh, I need to have this, I want to do this before I'm satisfied, before I'm contented with this. So to wrap all of this up, what is that major solution that can be done individually and collectively?
Well, if you ask me, I think we must learn to teach these young people how to love and accept themselves for who they are. How to love and accept the things that you cannot change about your own self. The shape of your hair, the shape of your nose, your eyes, your skin color. It will amaze you that more than 30% of young ladies bleach. because this is what is self love is
good.
Yeah, but in the long run, checking in trying to look good over a period of time, you can't even sustain it. And what God gives us naturally is still the best. Love yourself. People wouldn't, marriage is not built on color. A man might look at you like you're fair and say, wow, but the fairness cannot sustain love. The things that we see on the outside cannot sustain life and values. They are vanity. Well, some vanity, well, I'm not saying that they are good, but
choose your
own vanity. But to the point when you start thinking of altering yourself, changing yourself, trying to fit in, working so hard to be like some people, trying to talk like somebody. I mean, the things you do on the outside to make people accept you, calm down. And just start to sit by yourself and love yourself. And I also advocate that as much as possible, don't devote all your time to social media. You need to live a disciplined life. Yeah, so have a certain time that you go on social media, and also be careful of the kind of places you go. Some things are not better entering your heart. It's difficult to get them out. Once they are in, they try to control your life and all of that. So I said to a large extent, it's a matter of discipline. You need to apply discipline in life to be able to achieve what you really want to do. And sometimes also, don't just spend all the time with social media. Spend some time with yourself to sit down, think, write, go out. I mean, not just go without your phone.
Strategize,
and do all that. Yeah, make long-term plans and take steps. One step at a time. There's a lot we can say, like you say, but we can just have to cap it up.
That's cool. So, self-love, self-discipline, make plans, go out, love yourself.
Yeah.
Just do a lot of things that
And more importantly for me is to also be cautious of the kind of people that I talk to.
That's choosing your own
circle. Choosing your own circle. Careful, okay? Whether you believe it or not, people are product of influences. People are product of their environment. People are product of people that are around them. So if you find that certain people drive you it begins with you knowing what you want to do.
Okay.
Because if you don't know what you want to do, you won't know when someone is trying to take you against what you want to do. If you know what you want to do, find people who are, it's not because you hate them or so, but because your values don't match.
So you have to define your own value.
So, like I told you about that young lady I was talking to, she told me she met a young guy and they were going to start dating. And from the word go, she told the young man, well, okay, for me, no sex till marriage. And the guy said, bye bye. And then that was how it ended. Because values should actually define relationship, not the other way around.
That's very interesting. I've learned a whole lot, and I'm sure if he was at home, I've learned quite a lot. Thank you very much for coming.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you so much. I really appreciate you. Guys, please watch this video to the end, and if you have any questions for Mr. Shelby, please drop them in the comment box below. I'll sure see you guys in the next vlog. Don't forget to subscribe, and I'll see you in the next vlog. Bye.